I'm very happy to be here. And whatever I can share that will bless you is all that I want to do. Now, let me just put this on. I should be familiar with this. I hope that works. Is that better?
I speak up.
Okay. All right. Now, today I want to talk about the great experiment. Abraham Lincoln, with rolled up breeches and bare feet, roamed the hills, chased rabbits, and threw rocks in the creek, just as any boy his age would. But when he became a man, he made decisions of manhood. He squared his jaws. He had hard decisions to make, the decisions about nation, slavery, and war. George Washington, before him, faced hard decisions also, as every leader of every nation before him and after him. But as boys, they skipped through life. They were carefree, innocent, and fun-loving. But when the weighty matters of war and peace, of freedom and bondage, and of honesty and trickery faced them, they put away their childish ways and squared their jaws with manliness. For it is not easy to be a leader of a nation. The responsibility is heavy, no matter what the nation, yet the decisions you and I make every day are far weightier than any ever made by any leader during any time in this world's history. It's hard to believe that a decision by an individual trumps that made by a leader, even a despotic leader, over millions, but it's true. For a leader can never control the soul of another, ever. Only the individual has that prerogative. And it's a privilege he has for himself only. Even God cannot control the soul without the individual's consent, and neither can Satan. You, my brother and sister, are mightier than any king or queen of any past or current nation, and even mightier than God himself in this one respect alone. For you hold in your hands the destiny of your soul. None can touch it without your approval. This ability to choose is the greatest gift God gave Adam and Eve. And after the gift of Jesus, it remains the greatest gift sinful man has. Freedom of choice has become the great cleaving principle of the universe. It is and has been God's only experiment. He who controls deep space and one-celled organisms will not control the will of any being. What a wonder! What an experiment! The events in the Garden of Eden have not involved just the fate of man. God's respect for the sanctity of freedom reaches throughout the limitless universe, and somewhere, somehow, and in some way, religious liberty came to earth. So, let's sweep aside the curtain of history and look at the canvas of our past. We're all familiar with the first part of the Ten Commandments. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. And there's so much material, I'm not going to read all of it, but I put it up here for you to put it in your mind. And now I ask you, is religious liberty anywhere in the Ten Commandments? Do you think so? Not in this. Not at all. There is only one God portrayed here, and one God only. It is total worship of the God of heaven that he requires. In fact, the principle of religious liberty is not explicitly taught anywhere in the Old Testament. Religious liberty as an individual concept is not promoted, but liberty in general, which has far-reaching tentacles into religion is established. Right from the beginning, man was given freedom of choice. And we know this in Genesis, about every tree of the Garden of Eden thou mayest eat. But they were given a choice, even though God knew disobeying him would cause untold misery and death. He did not deny our first parents their freedom to choose. And what God has so graciously given them and had so graciously given them and has given us, no man is at liberty before God to take away. And this includes the right to worship after the dictates of conscience. But freedom of worship was a new idea on the eastern shore of North America 395 years ago. In fact, it was a hard-won idea during the millennium prior to that, when the papacy held sway over the lives of men and women, and before that, during the time of Nebuchadnezzar and other world leaders of antiquity. Religious freedom was virtually unknown. Those who insisted on it were forced into hiding in solitary places and often lost their lives. This is Karp Lykov, was one of those forced into hiding, an old believer, a fundamentalist of the Russian Orthodox sect, who worshipped in the same style as his ancestors of the 17th century. Old believers had been persecuted since the days of Peter the Great. And to Lykov, Peter was a personal enemy and the Antichrist in human form. Religious liberty became more curtailed when the atheist Bolsheviks took power. But when Lykov's brother was shot because of his Christian faith by a communist patrol, Lykov took his family along with a few possessions, including a family Bible, some seeds, and fled to Siberia, where they lived in total isolation for decades until oil prospectors found them. This is Lykov when the prospectors, the scientists, they were looking for oil. This is Lykov when they, well, soon after they found him, they didn't have cameras, I suppose, at the time, and his one of his daughters. And the next picture I wanted to show you is after they fled to Siberia. This is the home they were able to construct. Lykov, a Russian Orthodox and not a Sabbath keeper, was willing to live in complete isolation rather than lose his religious freedom. We may find ourselves living in the isolation of mountains and forests, of deserts and rocks, even of prison cell and armed guards. But we will not be alone, and we will not be left to die from hunger in the time of trouble. Just before the coming of Christ, the righteous will be preserved through the ministration of holy angels. But let's turn our attention now to the only beast in the Bible that has ever been recorded coming up from the earth, and that's in Revelation 13:11, and I usually we take time to look them up, but we won't now. And I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb and spake as a dragon. A new event is painted on the canvas of time, and that event resulted in the Constitution of the United States. And this is the preamble. I wish I could read it. But part of it says, to secure the blessings of liberty, the First Amendment to our Constitution, part of it says, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. And then I want to share a part of a letter written by Thomas Jefferson to the Danbury Baptists, believing with you that religion is a matter which lies solely between man and his God, that he owes account to none other for his faith or his worship, that the religious power, legitimate powers of government reach actions only and not opinions. I contemplate, and this is when he's president, I contemplate with sovereign reverence that act of the whole American people, which declared that their legislature should make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, thus building a wall of separation between church and state. And that's one of the famous places we get this separation between church and state. These deep and penetrating concepts, however, were not originally part of life in the early settlements along the eastern coast of America. In fact, they represent a profound change from the prevailing theology of the Massachusetts Bay Colony 160 years earlier. Religious totalitarianism was then the rule. In the summer of 1633, the Griffin set sail from the coast of England. She may have been a merchant ship like the Mayflower before her, a few decades before her, with three masts, three levels. People were usually in the second level, their possessions in the third level. And aboard her was John Cotton, a clergyman and the preeminent Protestant English scholar of his day. Even though he was a Puritan, he had been able to maintain his position as the minister of a large Anglican church for many years, and he was adamant about not separating from her. Even though the Puritans had many differences with the Anglican Church, while many ministers of his time were removed from their pulpits for their Puritan practices, Cotton remained in his for nearly 20 years because he had learned, using a conciliatory and gentle demeanor, the disingenuous art of disagreeing while maintaining the appearance of conformity. He was hypocritical. Cotton wanted to change the church from within while appearing to agree with her. Opposing forces finally became too strong for him, and he was forced to flee to the Puritan underground, and yes, they had an underground, and later he boarded the Griffin for New England, where he became the adversary of Roger Williams. Roger Williams was also a theologian and college graduate, but because of his Puritan beliefs, he didn't become a minister in the Church of England. Instead, he left England for the New World, arriving at the Massachusetts Bay Colony in 1633, 2 years before Cotton. He was immediately invited to be the minister of the Boston Church, but he declined because it was an unseparated church. Williams believed the Anglican Church was too corrupt in its practices for him to be part of it, and he taught separation from it. He also declined the offer because he couldn't agree with them that civil magistrates were to enforce ecclesiastical law and were to punish anyone who, for example, breached that first table of the Ten Commandments, which would include crimes of idolatry, Sabbath breaking, false worship, and blasphemy. Williams believed individuals were to have freedom to follow their own convictions in religious matters. He applied for a free man status in the colony, and that means, which means, yes, he would be a landowner without church association, but he was denied. Massachusetts Bay was a supposed theocracy, and no man was allowed to own property in the colony unless he first belonged to the church. The separation of church and state was a never before considered possibility, and Williams was not on the cutting edge. He was the cutting edge for this. Both he and it were not treated kindly. Nearly 150 years later, after the United States Constitution was signed and ratified, and after the ratification of the First Amendment guaranteeing religious freedom, the relationship of church and state was still a topic of debate. Edward and Charles Dilly, for example, hosted a dinner in their home in England And Samuel Johnson was their guest of honor. Samuel Johnson was the author of A Dictionary of the English Language, completed after 9 years of arduous labor and with the help of several assistants. Johnson was deeply religious and strongly political. Also attending the dinner were James Boswell, the future author of the biography of Johnson, Dr. Toplady, a clergyman and author of the lyrics for One Rock of Ages, and Dr. Mayo was also there, another clergyman. Here is part of the dinner conversation, modified from Boswell's Life of Johnson. "Every society," said Johnson. Just a minute. I have something down here I probably can get rid of. No. Anyway, I'll work with it. "Every society," said Johnson, "has a right to preserve public peace and order and has a good right to prohibit the propagation of opinions which have a dangerous tendency. It may be morally and theologically wrong for the magistrate to restrain the propagation of opinions which he thinks is dangerous, but he is politically right to do so." Said Dr. Mayo, "I am of the opinion, sir, that every man is entitled to liberty of conscience in religion, and that the magistrate cannot restrain that right." "Oh, sir, I agree with you," replied Johnson. "Every man has a right to liberty of conscience, and with that, the magistrate cannot interfere. But people confuse liberty of thinking with liberty of talking and liberty of preaching. Every man has a right to think as he pleases, for it cannot be discovered how he thinks. But no member of society has a right to teach any doctrine contrary to what the society holds to be true." "But, sir, I must be allowed to teach my children what I believe to be truth," argued Dr. Mayo. "Why, sir," replied Johnson, "you might contrive to teach your children scandalous things. And if the magistrate knows it, he has a right to restrain you. Suppose you teach your children to be thieves." "Ah, oh, that's making a joke of the subject." "Nay, sir, I disagree. It's not. Suppose you teach your children many plausible arguments for the use of other people's goods. You teach them that all things were at first common, that man has a right to anything he can lay his hands on, and that it had a right, and that it should continue to be his right. Here, sir, you put in jeopardy a great principle in our society, a man's property. Don't you think the magistrate would have a right to prevent you? Or suppose you should teach your children the notion that they should run naked in the streets. Would not the magistrate have a right to flog them into their doublets?" "I think," said Dr. Mayo, "the magistrate has no right to interfere till there is some overt act." Now Boswell speaks up, "But, sir, if a man sees an enemy to the state charging down the street with a blunderbuss," and that's a gun with that flared flare around it, "is he not right to interfere until it's fired off?" "Well," said Mayo, "he must be sure of what the direction is." Johnson said, "The magistrate is to judge that. For example, if I think it right to steal Mr. Dilly's plate, I'm a bad man, but he can say nothing to me. If I make an open declaration that I think so, he will keep me out of his house. But if I put forth my hand, I shall be sent to Newgate, a prison. Here is the gradation of thinking, preaching, and acting. If a man thinks erroneously, he may keep his thoughts to himself and nobody will trouble him. If he preaches erroneous doctrine, society may expel him. And if he acts in consequence of it, the law takes place and he's hanged." And then Toplady, who wrote that beautiful hymn we sing, agreed with him and said, "Sir, Dr. Johnson, you've made a complicated issue very clear. And that was Johnson's reasoning for the preeminence of state authority over religious beliefs. If a belief is promulgated that goes against commonly held beliefs, it is to be suppressed as dangerous. No individuality of speech or action, if schismatic, is to be allowed, for it is a detriment to the well-being of society. And I'm giving this background because we're going to be placed in the same position. Our liberty is going to be taken from us. And these are some of the reasons that may be used. You're a detriment to society. There are not many ways to God, as many think. Considering the thousands of religions we find in the world today, the privilege of having liberty has given birth to a landscape of religions. But in the Bible, religious liberty is not frequently taught as a doctrine of faith. It is a ready principle that we can derive from among other incidents, and two of those are found in Daniel. A liberty that God upholds, religious liberty is a liberty God upholds, and one that we champion. And next we have a quote from A.T. Jones. It's kind of lengthy, but it refers back to two experiences recorded in the book of Daniel, the one of Nebuchadnezzar and the worship of his great golden image, the other of the conspirators against Daniel's service when he was cast into the lion's den. All people are taught in the most impressive way that the God of heaven forbids any ruler to require his subjects to conform to his ideas in religion, and forbids all people to frame any law on any subject touching God's relation. And he bases this on the fact that God protected the three worthies in the fiery furnace, and and Daniel in the lion's den. Okay, let's move on because... But we champion it as Adventist, and one example is here from Ellen White in the Acts of the Apostles. The banner of truth and religious liberty held aloft by the founders of the Gospel Church and by God's witnesses during the centuries that have passed since then has, in this last conflict, been committed to our hands. Truth and religious liberty have been committed to us. Without religious liberty, man's freedom of choice is lost, which is a freedom even God does not remove from us. And in order to preserve it, he allows religions of every kind, such as Buddhism, Islamism, Hinduism, Catholicism, Shintoism, Judaism, atheism, and agnosticism, all 30,000 plus versions of Protestantism, including historic Adventism, Santeria. Instead of banishing all of these heathen or possible heathen and apostate religions, I'm not including historic Adventists, he calls his people out of them into a true worship of him, the only true God. He calls his people to be a peculiar people in the midst of perversity, and to be a holy people, strangers and pilgrims in a barren land. It is a solemn time for God's people, for they have deception on every hand and must walk trepidatiously. And the sad part is that all of these variant religions will look upon us as a cult, a danger to society, which is what the Seventh-day Adventist Church has tried to avoid by accepting Trinitarianism, a completed atonement at the cross, and the impossibility of perfection of character this side of glorification. Rita Swan was born in 1943, and raised a Christian Scientist. She is well educated with a PhD from Vanderbilt. Her husband also was raised a Christian Scientist and is also well educated with a PhD from the University of Vermont. They are both articulate, intelligent, and productive members of society. When their son Matthew was 15 months old, he began having trouble walking. Instead of seeking medical advice, they called a Christian Scientist practitioner who prayed for him. Next morning, had a fever and vomited. Next day, he was in a daze, unresponsive to playfulness, and Rita worried that the fever was continuing. But the practitioner reassured her that Matthew's fever was imaginary. 2 days later, he was motionless, immobile, and expressionless. I think we got the wrong file in here, so I'm going to try to skip through some of this. Matthew hadn't sat up, crawled, or walked for 3 days, and his condition continued to deteriorate. The parents changed practitioners, had prayer sessions, talked about taking Matthew to a doctor. Remember, a Christian practitioner, Christian Scientist, does not believe in medical help unless a bone is broken, and then they are allowed to see a doctor. And so they talked about ways, how can we get him to a doctor that won't go against our faith? But the practitioner dismissed it. Now he began having seizures and delirium. Finally, she said, okay, you can take him. Maybe he has a broken bone in his neck that's causing this. And so they immediately took him to an emergency room where he was diagnosed with bacterial meningitis, complicated by an abscess deep within the brain, and needed emergency surgery. Poor Matthew had not one abscess, but many abscesses in the brain, too many and too deep to drain, and he died a few days later. The parents finally realized they were part of a cult, and I'm bringing this up because we will be charged. I can't say for sure, Ellen White hasn't said that, but we know we will be denounced and charged by many things, and one of them could be very well be that we will be a cult. Are a cult. Perhaps our children will be close to death, or maybe we ourselves, because we will not deny Christ and re-enter Babylon. And very likely, we will be charged as being part of a dangerous cult, not just by a few people here and there, as we sometimes are, but at the end of time by the world in mass pressing hard against us. And we must be prepared prepared for this, because if you hear it during that time, the arguments used for being a cult might very well shake your faith, and we don't want that to happen. We will be accused of being a cult far worse than Christian Science, Jim Jones, David Koresh, Heaven's Gate, Scientology, Faith Assembly of this, and Snake Handlers Assembly of that, because most of the people in these organizations that I just mentioned are or have been Trinitarian or some version of it, and we are not. After probation closes, the masses of the world will be strongly marshaled against us and led in advance by their ministers. Now, I wanted to, let's talk about Billy Sunday for a minute. I have a picture of Billy Sunday back here. This is Billy Sunday. And he was a baseball player, and there he is strongly preaching. He used theatrics to the point that when he was on the platform, and here's another one, and this is an artist's conception, who was there and drew the picture of Billy Sunday preaching. And he would take a chair and break it on the platform to somehow emphasize what he was preaching. Now, in these last days, the masses that are going to be whipped into a fury against us, it's not just going to come from their mind thinking, oh yes, I have disasters here, it must be these Sabbath keepers over here. It's going to be preachers like this using passion, talking to their congregants about this sect over here is not doing what God wants them to do. And thousands of people came to the big tent where he was preaching. And praised him and loved what he was doing. Now, he wasn't the only one, but let me just give you an idea of the kind of person he was, in the sense that the common people could relate to him. I am a hayseed of the hayseeds, and the malodors of the barnyard are on me yet. I have greased my hair with goose grease and blacked my boots with stove blacking. I've wiped my old proboscis on a gunny sack. I've drunk coffee out of my saucer and eaten with my knife. I've said done it when I should have said did it. And I have saw when I should have said have seen. But I expect to go to heaven just as anyone else. I have crept and crawled out of the University of Poverty and Hard Knocks and have taken postgraduate courses in the School of Hard Knocks. And the people could relate to him about this. And at the end of time, when houses are destroyed, when there's disaster all around you, the people will relate to a preacher like this. Dwight Moody and Charles Spurgeon were also preachers of his time. Later, Billy Graham. We can expect similar forceful preaching during the end of time, and it will be directed against us. The so-called Christian masses will be whipped into action by their preachers, priests, and others, maybe even preachers in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And they will be propelled also, the masses will be propelled also by the disasters they see around them. They could very well be part of the disaster. Now, there are a few characteristics of a cult that we should consider, because there are parallels to Adventism. First, a cult controls the flow of information. For example, Rita and Doug Swan were instructed by their church to isolate themselves from all forms of medical information. If a television or radio program described an epidemic, they turned it off. If a newspaper or magazine article described a disease, they ignored it. As a consequence, the Swans knew nothing about medical health. They didn't even know a fever was a sign of infection. Rita didn't even own a thermometer. So, we could be considered controlling because we believe God is displeased with us when we go to listen to error without being obliged to go. For unless he sends us to these meetings where error is forced home to the people by the power of the will, he would not keep us. So we have parallels. We want to control what our senses have, but But the one thing to remember is that we do not force anyone to go or to stay. This is counsel to us, yes, but we are free to accept or reject it. We are not to give up our power to think for ourselves. Every human being created in the image of God is endowed with a power akin to that of their creator. This is Ellen White speaking. Individuality, the power to think and to do. Point two. Cult leaders believe they are chosen supernaturally. David Koresh, for example, believed he was Christ himself, the Messiah. Mary Baker Eddy wrote of divine interventions in her life and compared herself to Jesus Christ and believed she was chosen by God, and therefore her ideas were not to be questioned. We know God chooses all of us to be saved and that he has a plan for each one, but we do not believe our leaders are Jesus Christ personified, and we do not put faith into someone who claims to have new light which contradicts Scripture as those do who have accepted Joseph Smith or Mary Baker Eddy. We will be accused of being a cult, however, because we believe in the inspiration of Ellen White. But the one thing to remember is that she always pointed away from herself to our Heavenly Father and to Jesus Christ and counseled us never to take her words over the Bible. Cults, number three, teach that purity is to be obtained, but they really don't expect their members to achieve this. And this creates an impossible to be reached standard of perfection and results in shame and guilt when it's not reached. This double speak is in Scientology and Christian Science, for example. And while we believe character perfection is required by God, shame and guilt will not be present when we understand the great love God has for us when we sin and the wonderful forgiveness He gives us, and that Jesus is able to present us spotless before the throne of God. Mm-hmm. Our mistakes will then be turned into stepping stones to success. And then I have a quote from Christ Object Lessons. If you have made mistakes, you certainly gain a victory if you see these mistakes and regard them as beacons of warning. Thus you turn defeat into victory, disappointing the enemy. It has ever been Satan's purpose to cause men to believe God's standard for men is too high and that it cannot be reached. But we have something cults do not have and cannot offer their members. We have the power of the only God to help us in obtaining perfection. And Satan does not want us to achieve this and will never help anyone outside of the true worship of God to reach this. He'll never help anyone in a cult. And I didn't tell you about Agafia, who was the daughter of Lykov. She wouldn't return. Everyone died in her family, and she was left to live there in Siberia alone. And she wouldn't return to go back to her father's family. And I'm thinking, there she is in the beautiful country of Siberia, but the sky is overhead, the woods are all around her. God is very close to her, even though she wasn't a Sabbath keeper. And so just because you're not part of, you know, what we consider God's remnant, if you are true to God, just like Agafia was, He will bless you and help you learn more about Him. From Christ Object Lessons, we read, page 314, Satan had claimed that it was impossible for man to obey God's commandments, and in our own strength, it is true, we cannot do that. But Christ came in the form of humanity, and by His perfect obedience, He proved that humanity and divinity combined can obey every one of God's precepts. Amen. So when we have the mind of Christ, humanity and divinity are combined. What a marvel! We should always remember also from Christ Object Lessons, as the will of man cooperates with the will of God, it becomes omnipotent. Whatever is to be done at His command may be accomplished in His strength. All His biddings are enablings. Another point of a cult is it doesn't allow its basic teachings or its leaders to be questioned, and it's to be there to be considered. Inflexible, the beliefs, inflexible and absolute. And it's true, God's law is inflexible and God demands reverence. But it is not because He overpowers us to and denies our freedom of choice to obey Him. And I'm going to skip down. I see it's getting late here. If Adventism reacted so strongly to a threat of cultism by evangelicals Barnhouse and Martin that they wrote Seventh-day Adventist Answer Questions on Doctrine and repudiated our God-given theology for a new theology, and if they reacted so seriously to the change that the Church elevates Ellen White to the same level of authority as the Bible, that they do not require new members to they asked new members to affirm the gift of prophecy, but Ellen White is never mentioned in that, then you can be sure the Seventh-day Adventist Church does not want to be called a cult. So how should we respond? We should remember that any of these characteristics of a cult are forced upon people, but God never forces us. We have that freedom that He gave Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden to choose whether to follow Him or not. Satan has given rise to terrible organizations that can rightly be called cults, organizations that let children die rather than receive medical help, that control and kill people like ISIS, that dish out guilt and shame for not bending to the will of the leader, and that cause the loss of individuality of its members. And all of this is pre-orchestrated so that one day hatred and contempt can be cast upon us as we are that little flock, that small group of people that the world considers dangerous. We must be prepared to be attacked on any of these characteristics because they contain parallels to us. But the parallels all stop at one point. No force is ever used among God's people. Freedom of choice is always respected and honored. Freedom is utterly essential to God. He allows the terrible state of affairs we see now, gay rights, transgendered people, crack babies, abuse of the environment, abortion. He allows that rather than deny freedom and force the will. We hold in our own hands, brothers and sisters, one of the greatest gifts given to man, freedom of choice, and we are champions of it. And so was Roger Williams. John Cotton and Roger Williams were on opposite ends of the freedom spectrum. And to address this disparity, Williams published a treatise entitled The Bloody Tenet of Persecution for Cause of Conscience Discussed, and Mr. Cotton's letter examined and answered. And in this, he lists about 11 Bible texts that prove man is not to persecute man. And then Cotton reacted to it. But I would just want to share these Bible texts with you. The first one is, the wheat and the tares are to grow together until the harvest. Jesus said to let the blind leaders of the blind alone, not to go and persecute them, let them alone. The Son of Man is not come to destroy, but to save. The servant of the Lord is not to strive, but to be gentle to all men. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal. We're to love our enemies, bless them that curse you, pray for them. And another point is that there may be tares in the church, but they may become wheat like Saul did, and it may not happen until the 11th hour. And so we shouldn't be persecuting people because this could happen. Jesus sent his disciples as sheep among the wolves, not as wolves to kill the sheep and imprison them and spoil them. Men will deliver you up to the councils and scourge you. Those who are sent, as Jesus sent his disciples, are not to be the ones that deliver up and scourge. And when you enter a house, you're to salute it and let your peace be upon it if it's worthy. You're not to enter it to ransack it. And the good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. All of these texts teach that we're not to persecute those who differ from us in matters of faith. But Cotton disagreed and wrote a reply to some of them and totally ignored the others. But, for example, he said, I thought I had it here, that when we are to let the wheat and the tares grow together, he said, yes, I agree with that, as long as they're not speaking and preaching dangerous things to society. And as far as the blind, letting the blind leaders of the blind alone, well, he said, that really isn't relevant to us because Jesus was talking about the Pharisees, people we have no control over, so that doesn't apply to us. When he's about loving your enemies and blessing them that persecute you, this was counsel to individuals, not to church leaders and state leaders. And so he agreed with some things, but he added other points to deny it. It's obvious that Cotton would not talk, as far as the wheat, letting the wheat, the tares grow because they may become like Saul, become wheat? He said, yeah, I agree with you on that. But that doesn't sanction letting evil occur just because good may come out of it. And while we may be sensitive to the beauty of life about us, newlyweds in love with each other, sweet children in their charming ways, the flow of wind over tall grass, the music of the highest order, we must not forget the sure word of prophecy. Every day we must ask God to strengthen us for what we know is ahead, because he has told us in no uncertain terms. Number one, the servants of God will be given over to suffer humiliation and abuse at the hands of those inspired by Satan. Their envy and hatred against those who obey the fourth commandment, she says, will wax more and more bitter. Those who will be true to God and to duty will be menaced, denounced, proscribed, and betrayed both by parents and brethren and even kinsfolks and friends. Satan endeavors to terrify those at the end of time with thoughts that their cases are hopeless, that the stain of their defilement will never be washed away, and they will fear that every sin has not been repented of. Distress and anguish, she tells us, are before us. That requires a faith that can endure weariness, delay, hunger, and that will not faint, though severely tried. She also tells us that the most vivid presentation cannot reach the magnitude of the ordeal. And tomorrow we will talk about some of the most vivid, some of the ordeals people have gone through. Fearful sights of a supernatural character will soon be revealed in heaven, and the crowning act, of course, will be the impersonation of Christ. But God has told us how to prepare. We are to study. We are to pray. We are to look at the providences of God as something he gives us to develop our character. We may not like everything that's happening to us. We may wish things were a little bit different, but if we look at these things as God's providence for us to develop character, then they will become stepping stones to that. I'm going to skip over the quotes here. We are to know not only what's coming upon the earth, but we are to be able to claim his promises. And Ellen White gave several that she used in connection with the events that will occur. And one of them is Isaiah 30:29. Ye shall have a song as in the night when a holy solemnity is kept, and gladness of heart. So when darkness is all around you, you may be in that prison cell, you may be isolated somewhere else, you may feel a heaviness of your soul, claim this promise. You shall have a song as in the night when a holy solemnity is kept. And probably all of us have experienced that sometimes, waking up with a song in our hearts that we didn't go to sleep with the night before. God will give us a song, when, especially in our darkness. Another one is Revelation 3:10. I will keep thee from the hour of temptation which shall come upon all the earth. So, when you feel you're about to be crushed by the hour of your temptation, claim this promise. I will keep thee. Isaiah 27:5. Let him take hold of my strength, that he may make peace with me, and he shall make peace with me. So, when Satan is assailing you with your dark and scandalous past, hold on to this promise and you will make peace with God. Genesis 32:26, I will not let you go except thou bless me. And we know that's the time of Jacob's personal trouble, but there is a time when we will be troubled and we have to hold on and not let go. And God will bless us. We cannot hide our heads in the sand. We cannot close our eyes to the future or float downstream to disaster, To be forewarned is to be forearmed. We must study as if our lives depended on it and pray something like this every day. Father, we thank you for the blessings of the day, for the beauty of the earth, for the love of family. But you have told us what is ahead. May we never forget it. Make us ready. Strengthen us for this day, because we're all here. We're living in a nice world. Everything's peaceful and good. But it is not going to stay that way. And we cannot even imagine how bad it's going to be. And remember, the disciples of Christ, he tried to tell them about his crucifixion, that he would die. And it just went over their heads. We have, in the spirit of prophecy, preparation for us. But we kind of like to read the good parts, and we forget these bad things that are coming on this earth, and that we will be in the middle of it. So let's pray every day, thanking God for the blessings and the goodness, our families, and the beauty of the earth, but also not to lose sight of what's coming on this earth. Every person in every concentration camp, every person on every battlefield, every person on every sick bed has and has had that magnificent power of choice to decide whether or not to react to the particular circumstance with anger and hatred, or with the perfect trust of a child in a wonderful father. When we reach the end of this world's history, God's people will be looked upon as dangerous and worthy of death. President G.W. Bush often went to Walter Reed Medical Center. He was commander in chief, and he loved his troops. And in 2006, he went in the helicopter over to Walter Reed. Usually not announced, never announced, because of the security reasons. This time his press secretary went with him, and she related this later. The first Marine they were to see was in a coma, intubated. His Humvee had been hit by a bomb in Afghanistan, and he was sent over to Walter Reed. As the president walked with the chief naval officer and his attendants, the president's attendants, he asked, "How bad is it?" "We can't tell you, sir. We haven't been able to communicate with him. He hasn't spoken since he arrived or reacted in any way. But I can assure you, President, he has a long road ahead of him." So the president went into the room with the Marine. The Marine's parents, the Marine's wife, and 5-year-old son were present. And at the foot of the bed, the president spoke with the family that had assembled. And they were so happy to see him. They gave him hugs. They wanted a picture with the president. And the president spent time with them. And then he moved. He stayed there and said to his assistant, "It's time for the presentation." And so this assistant read in a low and steady voice the presentation for the Purple Heart, which is awarded to people who are wounded in action. Afterwards, the little 5-year-old son tugged at the president's coattails and said, "What's a Purple Heart?" And the president knelt down on one knee and gathered the little boy close to him and said, "It's a medal given to your daddy because he loves his country very much and loved the principles of his country and was very brave, that's right. And I want you to know that he loves you too, and he loves your mommy very much." And as he said this to the little boy, there was a commotion with the medical staff, and they started to go to the head of the bed, but the chief naval officer held them back and said, "I think, because the man had opened his eyes." And the naval officer said, "I think he wants his commander in chief." And so Bush immediately got up and went to the head of the bed and cupped that man's face in his hands and just kept eye contact with him for a while and then said to his assistant, "Read it again." And the assistant read the commendation for this soldier. And tears fell from the president's face onto the face of the Marine. And after they left, they visited other people in the center there, the medical center. One person, that most of them were glad to see the president, hugged him, were very happy he had come. But one family was angry. The mom was angry with the president and said, "Why is it that my son's lying dying in this bed and not your child?" And the husband tried to calm her down, but she was mad at the president and kept talking meanly to him. The president didn't walk out on her, just listened, tried to comfort her and say some words to her, but he saw she wasn't listening, so he just listened and tried to ease her pain by absorbing some of her pain, and eventually left. And as they went out, after all the visits and got back into the helicopter, the president turned to his press secretary and said, "That mama was sure mad at me, wasn't she? I don't blame her a bit." And this is to illustrate how tough it is to be a leader and make decisions over the lives, the physical lives of other people. But remember, no one controls your soul but you. You have that freedom that even God doesn't overstep and take it from you. This freedom, this religious freedom, yes, but liberty in all ways. God has given that to us. And that's why we see all this terrible destruction, lives being lost and all the things that I mentioned before, because God will not take freedom of choice away from us. Now I want to close. One Friday evening, several heard Ellen White proclaim, "Look, look!" And then she wrote these words of what she had seen. We might think it was of heaven. She probably did say, "Look, look," about heaven. But this time it wasn't. "The time of trouble was upon us. I saw our people in great distress, weeping and praying, pleading the sure promises," you need to know there's promises, "of God, while the wicked were all around us, mocking us and threatening to destroy us. They ridiculed our feebleness. They mocked at the smallness of our numbers and taunted us with words calculated to cut deep," should be deeply. "They charged us with taking an independent position from all the rest of the world. They had cut off our resources so that we could not buy or sell, and referred to our abject poverty and stricken condition. They could not see how we could live without the world. We were dependent upon the world, and we must concede to its customs, practices, and laws, or go out of it. If we were the only people in the world whom the Lord favored, the appearances were awfully against us. They declared they had the truth, that miracles were among them," and that's true, miracles will be among them, "that angels from heaven talked with them and walked with them, that great powers and signs and wonders were performed among them," and that's all true, brothers and sisters. "And this was the temporal millennium that they had been waiting for. The whole world was converted and in harmony." I'm going to skip down. "The angels of heaven have spoken to us," referring to those whom Satan personated that had died. They're saying, "We have spoken to people who have died, and these are angels coming back to us. Strong and terrible have become the masters of iniquity in the world." This is what she's saying, under the control of Satan. "But strong is the Lord who judgeth Babylon. The just have no longer anything to fear from force or fraud, as long as they are loyal and true. A mightier than the strong man armed is set for their defense." And I'm just going to skip down. An angel comes and says, They have come from the mountains, from the rocks, from the dens and caves of the earth, from dungeons, from prisons, from secret councils, from the torture chamber, from hovels, from garrets. They have passed through sore affliction, deep self-denial, deep disappointment. They are no longer to be the sport and ridicule of wicked men. And then she goes on to say, I have not time nor eyesight now to write all the wonderful manifestations that I have seen, but I cannot get it out of my mind, night or day. This was very real to her, and it should be real to us. And let me just go on. Freedom of choice is the one great experiment of God. Of course he knows the outcome, but the universe doesn't. They are watching the greatest experiment ever performed live, and it's played out in the lives of you and me. I don't know what I did, but I'm lost. Okay, I'll just finish. It's played out in the lives of you and me, and this is so frustrating. The movements of nations, the atrocities of Satan-possessed men and women, the pollution of the earth and of the oceans, the cries of innocent babies in horrible situations, as significant as they are, all fade collectively as the camera zooms in on us individually who are called by his name. Our commander-in-chief holds each of our faces in his hands as if it were the only one, and symbolically his tears fall on our faces because he knows what is ahead of us. He's sensitive to each of our needs, each frailty, each desire. But before he steps in, we must choose. Freedom of choice is the greatest gift God gave beautiful, sinless man. And in choosing to obey God, the greatest gift degraded sinful man can return to God. Such a choice makes the courts of heaven ring. The circle of freedom is complete. He gives us freedom, and we freely choose to obey and follow him. And, you know, it's so significant to me, because when we compare ourselves with Adam and Eve, we are puny physically. We are puny mentally. But we are spiritual giants if we stay close to God and do his will moment by moment. And this is what God is going to prove to the universe through us. We're nothing compared to how he created men and women, Adam and Eve. And so he's going to take the worst of the worst of human beings, so to speak, and make them the spiritual giants to prove that that Satan is wrong, that God's people can keep his commandments and can choose no matter how bad. And remember, it's worse than we can imagine.
Right.
But still, we're through a miracle of God, he's changed us, that we would rather die than sin, rather want than defraud. And I forget the rest of that quote, rather something than whatever. But that's what he will make us. And then we will bring glory to him, and the great experiment will be over.
Day by day.
Day by day, and with each passing moment, strength I find to meet thy trials here. Trusting in my Father's wise bestowment, I've no cause for worry or for fear. He whose heart is kind beyond all measure, give unto each day what he deems best. Loving bliss, part of pain and pleasure, mingling toil with peace and rest. Every day the Lord himself is near me, with a special mercy in each hour. All my cares he feigns and bear and cheer me. He whose name is Counselor and Power, the protection of his child and treasure, is a charge that on himself he laid. As your days, your strength shall be in measure. This the pledge to me he made. Help me then in every tribulation, so to trust thy promises, O Lord, that I lose not faithfully consolation offered me with thy holy word. Help me, Lord, when toil and trouble meet me, have to take as from a father's hand. One by one, the days of moment fleeting, till I reach the promised land.